please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Well, the markets at this point in time have lost a bit of their gains, but it's not as if it's gloom and doom. It's still a third of a percent higher, and it is still fresh highs, fresh all-time highs for the Sensex and the Nifty. But it's giving us a pause, and therefore we concentrate on more larger economy issues, and that's the power sector. As I told you before the break, the Allahabad High Court has denied any relief to power companies which had challenged the Reserve Bank of India's 12th February circular on bad loans. So what next for the power sector? Are they just going to be scrapped, liquidated, most of them? PV Ramesh, Chairman and Managing Director of REC, joins in to analyse the impact. Good morning, Mr. Ramesh, and thank you very much for joining us. Well, we've spoken to bankers all of yesterday, and we are told that about 10 or 15 power companies, they are very serious about a solution. But when you whittle down to actually where the agreements are signed, it looks like only 4 or 5 will make the cut. Really, what happens to the remaining 30 companies? Is it just liquidation?
Good morning and thanks for having me. And first, permit me to submit a caveat. The REC, being a non-banking financial institution, though exclusive in the power sector, is not really direct. The 12th February RBI circular does not apply to us.
Yes.
However, as an abundant measure of prudence, we have followed the same norms. I just want to submit that for the benefit of the viewers. So what I'm saying doesn't ipso facto apply to REC as such. Now, however, looking forwards, the power sector is much bigger than the stressed assets. I think that is the first point we need to note. We have an installed generation capacity of 344 gigawatts today. There's a rapid addition of the renewable energy that's taking place. However, the about 60,000 megawatts of the power is at various stages of stress. Now, there is an IBC process laid out in the Act by the Parliament. The RBI has issued a framework. We will follow those. We are working with other financiers to see how we move forward. I mean, we do believe that a substantial part of this segment, almost about 20,000-25,000 megawatts of the coal-fired thermal power stations have viability. Some of them have partial PPA, some of them have partial FSA, some of them are fully supplied but are not yielding adequate revenues to service the debt. So each one is different in its own way. We will have to work with the other lenders to see how to take this forwards.
Okay.
And we do believe, and let me also say this, I mean, you see a very clear trend in terms of increase in the demand for power. And one of the major reasons for this stress has been the muted demand for power. And we see all signs, early green shoots of demand for power increasing. And we would like to believe, given the level of investment that is being made by the government through Saubhagya, through Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana, and through reform of the DISCOMs, through Uday and various other interventions, you would see that all those infrastructure bottlenecks that existed for several decades in the transmission and distribution infrastructure would be evened out, and the demand would pick up quite substantially in the short term. And I think that would naturally address a number of issues, and this would increase the market, not just for the power, but also for the power generating plants that are under stress.
Okay. Mr. Ramesh, good morning. So you said 60,000 megawatts of power is in stress currently. Can you tell us how many accounts in total across banks may be pushed into NCLT, and what would the likely quantum be?
No, let me say this. I mean, these are they are different financiers who are involved in in this segment. So I wouldn't be able to say specific projects, because I can only speak for REC, where we have a limited exposure to these stressed assets. So I wouldn't like to comment, but I'm looking at the big picture. because of the fact that has an implications for the future of the power sector. So what I have said is basically conceptually important to understand the direction in which we are likely to move.
Sir, the Allahabad court came with two other parts to its judgment, which were, more in terms of consultation. The government has to consult under Section 7 of the RBI Act. They have to consult with the RBI and, finish that consultation in 15 days. And plus, the high-powered committee under the cabinet secretary should present its report in 2 months. In your best assessment, what can these two consultative processes do? What possible pragmatic changes can they make to save some of these 25,000 plants you were talking about?
I'm not qualified to speak on behalf of the government. However, the directive of the Allahabad High Court that the government of India has the authority to give a directive to Section 7, that's a sovereign authority any government enjoys to give any directive in the public interest. And so that's one part, of course, the Allahabad High Court has flagged. And the other issue is to complete the high-level committee that has been set up by government of India under the chairmanship of the cabinet secretary, and which includes all the key secretaries of the government as well as the heads of key financial institutions that have a majority exposure to the power sector. And it has a comprehensive, far-reaching set of terms of reference that should address all dimensions of the stress as well as the future of the power sector. That the court has stipulated a time frame of 2 months from the date of issue of the order. And I'm sure the high-level committee would take note of these directives and then would move forwards.
Okay. You did mention to us that you are following these norms as well and you have limited exposure to these assets. Can you tell us exactly what is the exposure that you have to these assets and how will the provision requirements change for the accounts that you will be referring to NCLT?
Let me say two things. One is, of my loan book, which is about 2,50,000 crores or so, is about 85% is actually in to the state sectors where there is absolutely no stress. So about 15% is what we have lent to the private sector, of which 2% is in the transmission, 13% is generation, and that stretches across gas, coal and the hydro. So our exposure in that sense overall is limited. As you know, our gross NPAs are around 3% of the total. And as far as the provisioning norms are concerned, we have made already advanced provisioning. So this would not affect our provisioning requirements, the reference to NCLT, because it is one continuum in a way, the process. It's pre-NCLT resolution process and the NCLT resolution process. So it's a one single continuum. As far as the provisioning norms are concerned, they do not get affected. We have already made provisioning. In fact, in some cases, we have been overcautious in terms of provisioning. So we've done whatever is required to be done under the norms stipulated by the RBI. So that would not affect substantially our...
How many of your borrowers may end up in NCLT, you think?
That we will have to see how many would finally go. It would not be a large number.
Okay.
I wouldn't be able to put a figure to that, but it would not be large.
Okay. Any one guess what the what the cabinet secretary's committee can do? So much hopes are pinned on them. Anyone guess what they might advise?
No, I think that's for the committee to take a view on this, and I'm sure it will take a considered view. It would consider all aspects. If you look at the terms of reference, they are comprehensive, they are far-reaching, they are futuristic, they look at all dimensions, at the regulatory, at the fuel supply, the power purchase, the payments by the DISCOMs, range of issues.
I'm asking you, is there any plan that they will take your Parivartan plan? Today some brokerages have written that it is quite possible that NTPC will be asked to manage some of the plants, which means, NIIF or somebody has to buy up some of these plants at rock bottom values and ask NTPC to run it. Is there even a reasonable chance that will happen?
I mean, that is also part of the terms of reference. I mean, to consider, I mean, setting up an asset management and revitalization company as we proposed under Parivartan, which I think is a comprehensive solution to this problem, because we are transitioning through a high supply to a high demand scenario. And so we would require a warehouse that could be managed in the interim. So, and the second, so I think that is very much on the table, and I'm sure it will receive due consideration by the committee. And much more importantly, we also need to recognize that there were several states actually have started to look at these assets, and the states do require, and they do have the surplus manpower as well to manage these assets. So you would see a lot more interesting formulations emerging in the coming days. So in the states, the NTPC, there are other players who could get into the play.
Okay, you did mention
we would
that
work
you
with
have
them. We would work with all of them. Yeah,
sure. You did mention
yes,
that
ahead.
You have a 13% of loan exposure to private power producers. I just wanted to understand the provisioning that you will make. Have you made it already? Will the provisioning go up in the quarters to come?
No, I mean, when I said 13% of my loan book is to the private sector, it is not all stressed. It's a very small part of it that is that has an exposure that has that is under under stress. And okay. Wherever we needed to do provisioning, we have already made, yes.
Right.
So, I mean, I just let me clarify that the 13% is the total financing given
sure.
to the private sector. It is not what is under stress.
Fair point. That point is taken. I don't think you have a big problem. We didn't invite
No, I
you
don't to... have a big problem, but I'm... I don't have a big problem, but I'm concerned about the bigger problem.
Sure. That's why we invited you. That's why we invited you, Mr. Ramesh. Thank you very much indeed for joining us with your thoughts. Well, for the moment, we have to take a break. Still ahead, HSBC's economist Pranjal Bhandari joins in to talk about a very interesting report that she has written.
All right, after brief episodes of undershooting to 6.2% and overshooting to 7.8%, a recent HSBC report expects growth to remain elevated in the first half of 2018 and return to the trend rate that is 7.1% by the end of the year. Pranjal Bhandari, the chief India economist of HSBC and the author of this report, joins us now to talk about that. Pranjal, we'll of course talk about growth in a bit, but before that, you know, interest rate hikes across the globe are becoming an increasing phenomenon now. What are you expecting from the RBI at the next meeting? Should we expect more rate hikes?
We're expecting a rate hike in December. By then the MSP regime will have got implemented, the new one. So on the back of that, one in December. After that, we're expecting a pause for the next couple of quarters. But there could be risks of further rate hikes in the second half of 2019. And I'll probably speak about it in context of my report.
Okay. Now, is your report that our trend growth is 7.1%?
Yes, that's correct. So, our calculation of potential growth suggests that, the GDP in India should be around 7.1%. And it's been so in the last couple of years. What we find is that in 2016-17, growth actually undershot 7.1,
yeah.
Growth averaged 6.2. And that's because of the disruptions on the back of demonetization and GST. But as soon as we started with 2018, in the first half, January to June, we think growth has been very high. It has been overshooting the 7.1% trend. Actually, it's been averaging 7.8%. And there are two reasons for this. One is a low base from last year, and second is inventory restocking. There was no big restocking exercise for many quarters, and all of that sort of got bunched in the first half of 2018. So that explains high growth. On February, on Friday this week, we are going to get the second quarter of 2019 growth number. It's going to be a very high number, close to 7.8% by our analysis. But that's where the high growth numbers stop. In the second half of 2018, we think growth is going to begin to slow again towards the trend of 7.1. And that is something we'll have to be very careful about because it matches up with a lot of things. For instance, core inflation. In the first half of 2018, when growth was overshooting, core inflation was also very high because the output gap was closing. And on the back of that, you saw two back-to-back RBI rate hikes. But as in the second half as growth slows, we'll see the momentum in core inflation slowing as well. Actually, we've already seen that for two readings, the momentum slowing a little bit.
Okay. What about private capex? Are you seeing any kind of pickup or nascent signs of recovery in the private capex cycle?
Yeah, a good question. You know, actually 2018, we are, you look at the private capex from many dimensions, year-on-year growth, the capex rate, and the one I like the most is new investment intentions by the private sector. All of them have recovered. In fact, new investment intentions are at a five-year high at this point, and these are good signs. But I don't think there's going to be any major acceleration in capex from here onwards. And that's because of a couple of reasons. One is, you know, uncertainties with elections coming up. There's going to be a lot of political uncertainties in the environment. Financial conditions are pretty tight. The twin balance sheet problem is still getting resolved. On the back of all this, you know, investment is looking better than before, but not in a place to accelerate yet. Of course, your second question would be, when could we think about an acceleration in private capex? Mm. And I think, you know, once the election is done in next year, and assuming that it's not a decision that spooks the private sector, then I think from the second half of next year, we can start thinking of a decent improvement in private capex. And I say that because investment intentions are rising. It means the private sector wants to begin to invest. They're just looking for the right time. So if the election uncertainties are behind them, it could be a nice time for them to start investing, which we think will be from the second half of 2019.
Okay, so 7.1 is the potential of the economy as of now. Do you think that with a favorable combination, what you call an election result that does not spook private investors, and maybe disciplined behavior in terms of fiscal deficit, you are talking about that as well. Do you think then our trend growth rate could look better from 2020?
Yes, although that will take some time, so it won't be immediately in 2018 or 2019. We'll have to probably wait till 2020. And if all the conditions you outlined are true, and also if world growth is supportive, yep, which is a very, very important part in, you know, in India's growth trajectory, then from 2020, you could start seeing a period in which we'll start seeing the growth dividends of all these reforms like GST and bankruptcy code that we've done. You know, we'll allow those to stabilize. Also impact of higher private capex, all of that increasing potential growth in 2020. That's the time when, you know, India could start increasing its potential growth once again in a sustainable fashion.
Okay, Pranjal, you know, that's a topic for a much broader discussion on a later date. India's potential growth is only 7% or 7.1%. Yeah. We were up until, you know, over the last 15 years, believing it is double digit, it is at least 8%. But no, the economists say our potential is only 7%, and probably we will be able to increase it if all IBC and, you know, stable political institutions and global growth all kick in together, then the potential increases perhaps. But that's discussion for another day. For the moment, it's stable markets, actually. The dip has not been all that bad. So we will have our Chartbusters team back here with technical experts to tell you whether this is a time for short positions or long positions. Thank you very much for watching Bazaar.